You've been surrounded in your career as a journalist and now as an author, right? You've been surrounded You've been surrounded by great storytellers, women storytellers, even when you were starting as a young journalist. Do you hear me? Can you hear me, Marga?
I seem to have lost the audio. Give me a moment.
Okay. I'm talking right now. I'm talking right now, and then Marga Ortiga is on screen trying to figure out the audio. We have it? You have us back?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. So as I was saying, earlier on in your career, you were surrounded by, you know, great women storytellers, right? And even now as an author, you're exposed to that as well. What makes women good and great storytellers, Marga? Tell us.
I think it's because, I don't want to generalize, but women, in a sense, I guess historically, have been expected to stand back, right? And because we stand back a little bit more than the men might be expected to, I think we pay attention more to what's happening around us. And because we're paying attention more, we are then better able to put things together or understand what's happening in a different way to somebody who is more proactive or more involved in the activity that we are then witnessing. Mm. Again, I don't mean to generalize, but I'm just saying maybe in a historical context that can explain why women are, the nuances in the way a woman tells a story might be very different to the way a man might. And the things that we pick up even when we're working on the field will be very different. And that's something I touch upon as well in There Are No Falling Stars in China, where at one stage we were an all-woman team in one particular story. And because we were all women, we were able to tell a very different story than a man might have, because we were allowed into certain places that men were not allowed. And they spoke to us differently because we were women. Mm. So I think it's just each individual, really, and not just limited to the gender, mm-hmm. will attack stories very differently. And that's why the very same event can be covered by many different reporters in a variety of ways. And that's because I think we bring our entirety as individuals in the way we then tell the stories that we witness.
Mm. And I want to wrap up this conversation, Marga, with this final question. And I feel like before I ask you this, I feel like we need to have a drink of some sort to just really ponder on what you're about to say. But what is that one story that you're just really waiting to tell, whether it's as a journalist or as an author?
You know, I think it might change, because at one stage, that one story I really wanted to tell was Sombra. Just because I felt it was a story that I think I had always wanted to see out of the Philippines. And, you know, they always say, tell the story you'd like to read. Mm. And that's what I did with Sombra. And then I thought I was done. And then suddenly the stories that came out that are in No Falling Stars from China just started to kind of repopulate my brain, if you will. And I was like, oh yeah, I wish I could, you know, maybe I should write. And then you start to put things down, and it just felt like, maybe I should put this in a book and share it with people. And of course, you know, you have friends or colleagues who are like, oh, you really should tell that story about that time in Poland, or mm-hmm. oh, you really should tell that story about this. And I was very aware of the fact that these were experiences that are not available to the many. So if it made a mark on me and I learned something from it, maybe I can share what I took from it with other people. And that's mm-hmm. what I did with There Are No Falling Stars. And then the next book, it was that. Again, it was another story that, it's not exactly like it was sitting at the back of my head this whole time, but it just started to bubble up to the surface. Mm. And so I went with it, and that's where the third book came from. Mm. And same with the fourth. So it's more like maybe it's what's inside rises to the surface when it's time. Mm. Maybe that's what it is. And then at some stage, I begin to just start to listen to it and try to capture it and put it down on the page.
Finally, Marga, you know, listening to you, you're one of the lucky ones, right, who were given the opportunity to sort of lead another life, right? Women most especially, we're expected to sort of lead a linear life. After this, you
yes.
move on to this. After this, you move on to this. But not the case with you. What do you tell women now who do want to sort of, venture out of that linear life that they lead, and but they're just afraid, or they just, the doubts, I think it's, are louder than that inner voice.
I think it's really the fear. It's the fear that is our biggest traitor. I think we are so fearful to veer off the path that we have been told to be on, that we chain ourselves often to the unhappiness of not just ourselves, but the people around us, right? And the thing with me is, like you had mentioned, we're of a generation where things were still very easily plotted out. You went to school, after school, you got a job, after you get a job, you get married, you start a family. You know, there was a plan that was already in existence, and you just kind of had to slot yourself into that. And what happened with me is that as much as I thought I had this plan, kind of like life had other plans for me, because nothing worked out the way I had thought it would. And so I had to constantly pivot and adjust and pivot and adjust. And through doing that, you learn to go with the flow. And at the end of the day, I can't necessarily say this is what I had planned for myself, but I learned that even in the best of times, sometimes life has other plans for us that turn out better than we ourselves could have ever imagined. So I think I just learned to go with the flow and released fears very early on. But it's not to say that I'm not afraid, because of course we all still have our fears. Do you know what I mean? That's part and parcel of being human. But what I've learned to do is not be chained by it. I might be afraid of something, but what I then do is just go head first into it so that I can get over it. It's like, I don't like living in the fear, so I'm just going to do it, or I'm just going to attack it so that I'm done with it and I'm no longer afraid. And that's kind of how I've dealt with things as they've come along. So what can I say to women these days? Trust your gut. Trust your gut. And no matter what, I firmly believe you can't make a mistake. So go and try it out. Go and dip your toe in the water. Go and try to chase that dream. And if it doesn't work out, I am sure it would lead you to something else that might be better for you anyway, or that might bring you greater joy than you had originally anticipated. So just trust yourself and then trust the flow of your life.
Marga Artigas right there, journalist and author, one of the remarkable women we honor this month. Thank you for paving the way. Really appreciate it. Take
care.
Thank you. I'll see you soon. The outside world is waiting, Marga.
Thank you, Carmina.
Thanks.
Thank you.